Thank you. Hi, everyone. Can you hear me? All right, we'll get started as soon as these last plates get filled up and people take their seats. So in a couple of minutes. That doesn't mean you have to stop talking. All right, I think we should get started. Welcome, everyone, to the City Building Design Lab. My name is John Brown, and I'm the Dean of the School of Architecture, Planning, and Landscape, and I am absolutely thrilled to see a full house here on one of our very first in-person events. This is an interesting place to meet. It's an interesting time of the year to meet, in the fall when the bounty of the harvest is being brought in, and we have a sense of the changing of the seasons. And of course, last week we had our Truth and Reconciliation remembrance or acknowledgement on Friday. And it's always interesting for me to be here because we're literally only a few hundred meters from the place where the Bow and the Elbow River cross, and the traditional meeting place for millennia of the indigenous peoples. That originally called this place Mokinsis, and now we call Calgary. And so in the spirit of the fall harvest and in recognition of the importance of land and the idea that we're actually going to be talking about landscape photography tonight and the way in which we understand and see the land, the indigenous ways of seeing and stewarding the land are also important and something that we need to acknowledge. We obviously also need to acknowledge that we are here as their guests, and we acknowledge the need for a reconciliation of parallel paths with the indigenous people who have done so much for so many millennia to this. And specifically, that refers to the people of Treaty 7, which I found out I was at Dean's Council yesterday, it seems like a year ago, and the Dean of Law was giving the acknowledgement, and he said, did you know that in 1877, up some sort of not far from here, Colonel MacLeod, I think it was, and he named the people, actually came and signed Treaty 7. And in his land acknowledgement, as law, he talks about how most of the components of that treaty were broken over and over and over and over and over again. I think in the way that I talk about it as architects, planners, and landscape, it's about stewardship, it's about the way we think about the land, about ecology, about reverence for the place in which we are at. And I think that there is we also have sins that we as professions need to account for, but I think that there is a sympathy between the two paths that is quite remarkable. So just to conclude, the Treaty 7 is obviously the, as you probably well know, the Blackfoot Confederacy comprising the Siksika, the Piikani, and the Kainai First Nations, as well as the Tsuut'ina First Nation and the Stoney Nakoda First Nations, which comprises the Chiniki, Bearspaw, and Wesley First Nations, and that the city of Calgary is also home to Métis Nation Region 3. So, as I mentioned at the beginning, I welcome you all to the City Building Design Lab. Some of you, this might be your first time here. We've been here for 4 years, 2 years of which we weren't here, we weren't here physically, but we were here in spirit. This is a place that was generously provided by Calgary Municipal Land Corporation and the City of Calgary for us to be able to activate this main floor of the old public library to bring our students down. We have 100 students working in the front of the building. We have our gallery. Dr. Alberto de Salvatierra's work is being displayed there right now. And then we use this space to congregate and to talk about cities and to talk about place and to talk about design. And we do this monthly, more or less. We take a break over Christmas, and I'm not checking my email. I'm just bringing up the photograph that I took of the
poster to show that the next Design Matters lecture series event will be on November the 2nd. It's called Design with Sustainable Materials. We have invited the architecture firm Schmidt Hammer Lassen from Copenhagen to come here to speak. We're still figuring out which one, Schmidt Hammer Lassen or one of their, probably not one of those three, but somebody prominent from that firm will come here. And if you know, well, actually, Snoetta, the architects for the for our lovely library are from that part of the world, and Copenhagen, Denmark is one of the hot spots in design right now. So, and also a leader in sustainable design. So I highly encourage you all to come and to be part of that. This event, and as you all know, doesn't happen just with us. It happens as a result of our very generous sponsors, and I want to acknowledge those. We have EXP Engineering, Architecture, Design, and Consulting, Element Integrated Workplace Solutions, DIRT, which is a modular office solutions company, Woodworks, Wood Products Council, Canadian Wood Council, the Alberta Real Estate Foundation as well. And I wouldn't be a dean if I didn't say, and if you're interested in sponsoring a lecture, come and see me afterwards. Without their generous contributions, we wouldn't be able to have the food, bring in the lovely speakers that we have, and to be able to come together and talk about what we think is really important. And obviously, I hope you think it's important too, because you are here. We have, I'm supposed to tell you where the washrooms are, which I didn't do at the beginning. The washrooms are in the basement. There is a washroom here, but apparently they didn't fill the paper towel dispenser, so you might not want to use that one. But just downstairs, there are two lovely bathrooms that were done up after the flood in 2015. On October the 13th, we have an event at here. It is the closing reception for the Planet of a Thousand Cities, which I mentioned earlier, which is our show out there, and it actually coincides with the hosting of a celebration of a charrette, which is a short design project thing that we call, it's what designers call, now they call them sprints, but charrettes, to look at reimagining West downtown. And there's a group of international experts are coming to Calgary, working with the City of Calgary and Stantec, a local architect or a local design firm, to come up with ideas. They're collaborating with Alberto and his team on with the Civic Commons Catalyst project, and so we'll be having that event happening on October the 13th, and you can register on our website. And then for students, there's an Alberta Professional Planning Institute meet and greet on October 14th that we also would hope that you would come. So now to the matter at hand. It is my extreme honor and pleasure to introduce to you this evening's speaker, Luca Nostri. He's a photographer, a researcher, and a teacher based in Lugo, Italy, a long way from here, as he told me. Luca has been working with a group of our students all of this week on a short course, a five-day intensive short course on landscape photography, and that exhibition will be opening up in our gallery on campus in a couple of weeks. Luca holds a PhD in photography from Plymouth University, and his work explores notions of landscapes, place, memory, and belonging with an interdisciplinary approach that revisits the tradition of documentary photography. And examples of his work are on those tables over there, and they are stunning. His photographs are included in the collection, and I'm going to butcher this, apologies Luca, and to Enrica, of the Linea di Confine Rubiera, RE, the American Academy in Rome, the Macro Museum, and the Maxi Museum, which I have been to. It's an amazing, amazing place. Since 2014, he has been a member and teacher for the Architectural Association School of Architecture in London, which is fabulous. And his first monographic book, Anselmo, was published in 2020. So without any further ado, I introduce our evening speaker, Luca Nostri. Welcome.
Thank you, Dean John Brown, for this great introduction. And thank you, everybody, for being here. Thank you, University of Calgary. And in particular, I would like to thank you, Professor and Landscape Architect Enrica Dallara, for inviting me here. And also the students for all of the efforts they are putting into this intense block week. So thank you really much. So let's start, actually. Actually, this talk can have two titles. The first one is slightly more academic and is Place and Identity in Italian Photography Through a Study of the Town of Lugo. So first of all, Lugo is my hometown, is the place I come from in Italy. I can say that as a photographer, my work has always been inspired by a long-standing, wonderful and venerable tradition of photographers who have explored their surroundings rather than going to exotic places or traveling or interested in news. They are more interested in exploring what is familiar, what is supposed to be known. But maybe sometimes through photography you realize that there's something new or magic or mysterious to discover. Another interesting or important word, I think, for my work is place. When I recently I did a PhD in photography, it was an adventure that was not expected. It just happened, and I went for it. Then at some point I regretted it because it was so much work. And but finally I managed to do it. What was interesting is that I had the chance to deepen my relationship with place also through by studying and deepening other disciplines like cultural geography or human geography, and that was very interesting for me to conceptualize notions of place in relation with photography. Obviously Italian photography is another important part of my work, because my work in a way is embedded in an Italian tradition, which I'm about to explain or share mostly. So what is interesting is that the name of my hometown, Lugo, actually means place. The Italian word for place is luogo. So you take the O down and it's Lugo. So Lugo is like an ancient word for place. It comes from Latin, Lucus Augusti, which is the sacred wood or a clearing in the woods hit by sunlight, which also has an interesting photographic atmosphere. And it's actually the place from where the Romans used to start from when they colonized the new territories. And so, Lugo is as an ancient story from the Romans, but also before. Another thing you need to know about Lugo is that more or less is here. And that's enough so far, really. So again, it's it's a long way from here. And what I'm about to share is quite personal, and I hope it will make sense to all of you. Actually, it's more interesting to start from this map, which is, again, a geographical map, but most important is the cover of one of the most important Italian photography books. It's dated 1984, and it's called Viaggio in Italia, Journey to Italy. It was organized and curated by a photographer, Luigi Ghirri, one of masters of Italian photography, who died in the 90s. And today is considered a pioneer, very, very important photographer, highly influential. And for this project, he gathered a number of photographers who were exploring new notion of landscapes. They were investigating the landscape in a completely new way. But let's start from the book cover. It was designed by Ghirri's wife, and the idea for this map is that this is exactly one of the maps that used to be in primary elementary schools after post-World War II. It was basically in all the schools. So in a way, it was a reminder for Giri's childhood. And in fact, in a picture from an archive I have investigated in my hometown, an archive about post, you know, from 1946 onwards, so it's post-war period in Lugo, 1946, this is 1953. It's a small hamlet near Lugo, Passo Gatto. It's a photograph of an elementary school, and on the wall there is exactly the cover of Luigi Ghirri book, so as a proof that in the what is in the history or art books is actually true sometimes. And so today I'd like to take you to a small but hopefully interesting viaggio in Italia. So again, this title has a numbers of references. Viaggio in Italia, the voyage in Italy is quite an old idea. The first time we have this word, the viaggio in Italia, was in 1670. And the first time this expression appeared is in a book by a French priest, Richard Lascelles. And basically, Viaggio in Italia was part of the Grand Tour. I'm sure most of you are familiar with this idea or habit, but for those who are not, the Grand Tour was a traditional trip through Europe with Italy and France as well as a key destination, undertaken by upper class young European men, obviously quite rich because nobody could afford that. And the primary value was to be exposed and learn and explore the richness of Italian cultural tradition and light and history, also music. So it could last from months to several years, and a lot of super influential and important artists, writers have done that. So in the cover book, so basically these Italian photographers with the title wanted to, in a way, address this old adventure. For example, like a couple of examples for super, super important paintings from artists who have undertaken the Italian journey. One of my favorite is Thomas Jones. Is not one of the most well-known, but it's basically is one of the people who have invented the en plein air painting. He did a wonderful journey in Naples, which didn't go very well, but his paintings in time they are considered incredible masterpieces. Also, it's interesting, these paintings are as big as the palm of my hands. They are super small oil paintings, very intimate, very beautiful. They are in museums in Britain, and they are really, really so small. So this is a bit not the best way to look at them, or not a way probably Thomas Jones would have liked to look at them, but you know, it's that's it. And another most famous, Camille Corot, who did wonderful landscape paintings in Italy for a long time. So there are references of that in Viaggio in Italia, and there are references in literature. So the Viaggio in Italia was also explored by writers, Goethe, of course, the Italienische Reise, and other Italian writers, Guido Piovene, but also Ceronetti. And the Viaggio in Italia is also in cinema. Neorealist director Roberto Rossellini. This is a very famous Italian movie. Again, it refers to this Viaggio in Italia, so it's like a couple of British husband and wife traveling to Italy and having an interesting adventure. So, obviously, the Italian photographers were referencing the Viaggio in Italia in an ironic way as well, because for them it was not an exotic place, it was the place they belonged to. In the book cover, there's in the back cover, there's a sort of manifesto who explains how Viaggio in Italia was born out of the need to make a journey in the newness of Italian photography, and in particular to see how a new generation of photographers, neglecting the mythology of exotic trips, sensational reporting and formalistic analysis and spurious forced creativity, have instead turned their gaze to the reality and the landscape that surround us. And the last part is quite interesting and poetic. The intention is to reconstruct the image of a place. The journey is both anthropological and geographical, and thus become a search and the possibility of activating a knowledge that is not a cold scientific category, but rather an adventure of thought and gaze. So for me, this idea of the adventure of thought and gaze without the need to move too far away from where you are, it's quite interesting and beautiful. And it was something I always try to achieve with photography. So let's have a look at some of the pictures that were produced during this wonderful experience. Actually, it's interesting that when Luigi Ghirri curated the project, he gathered a number of photographers, they were 20, and a writer, Gianni Celati, very, very important writer, who is also translated in English. He was traveling with photographers and actually learning from their practice. Some of the pictures that are included in this book were produced for the project, while some of them were just collected from the photographer's archive. This is just because this is just to acknowledge the fact that all these photographers were independently doing something very similar, and so Luigi Ghirri was smart enough, able enough, and capable of reading a cultural context that was happening, and had the strength and the resolvefulness to gather them and did this wonderful exhibition of 300 photographs. They opened the exhibition open in Bari. Very beautiful picture by Luigi Ghirri. These landscapes are, these pictures are very quiet. They are really poetic. It's a journey through Italy, but avoiding a lot of stereotypes of the Italian landscape. They were avoiding very famous monuments, or there are some monuments, but they are approached with a completely new gaze. They are like very quiet. Sometimes in many of them, the photographers were trying to experiment with the language. They were interested in the photographic language as well as in photographic content, because they are actually pictures of countryside, banal countryside in the middle of nowhere. Sometimes is in famous places, like this is Capri, but it's a picture that suggests a metaphor for looking rather than exploring, you know, rather than a picture of the beautiful Capri rocks. And pictures that deal with vernacular landscapes and the tradition of farming, which obviously is in Italy, is a part of where we are and where we come from. Very poetic, like this is a very famous picture by Guido Guidi, which is my maestro at the Academy of Fine Arts in Ravenna. His description says Villa dei Sogni, Villa of Dreams. So It's very poetic because it's actually looks like the opposite of the Villas of Dreams, but it's a very wonderful touch. Also, the moment of the day, the way the light, it's hitting the shadow, it's hitting the door, it's really, really beautiful. The way the picture is, the way the house is contained into the frame. New stuff for Italian photography, really new stuff, back in late 70s, early 80s. So some of the protagonists of this adventure are, again, Luigi Ghirri and Guido Guidi, Mario Cresci, two beautiful pictures from south of Italy, Olivo Barbieri, a pyramid of watermelons, quite nice, Giovanni Chiaramonte, Gabriele Basilico, with his work about the Milan factories, thank you. Another industrial area. This is another quite funny pictures about how to try to create order and little beauty in a quite awful and landscape by Vittore Fossati. Very subtle observation. Again, metaphor for vision, photography as a threshold. Beautiful picture by Luigi Ghirri. Actually, it's working in a similar, it's also a threshold. One is open, one is closed. Here, the really amazing photograph where the window also as a metaphor, yeah, for vision. Andrea Cavazzuti. They are quite different in style sometimes, but all these photographers were interested in the same topic, and they have a similar approach. Actually, what was super, super important for me is that by chance, one of the pictures was taken in my hometown in 1982. And for me, this when I started doing photography, and in my mid-20s, I started having an understanding of where I wanted to go with photography. This picture came out like as a punch in my face, and I was living in Rome at in those days, and at some point I moved back because I wanted to deal with the place I come from, being there, photographing them, doing research there. And so this is a picture of one of Lugo main squares, the Pavaglione. It's architecture from 17th century, and there is a strange coincidence about architecture, because this not this picture, but this architecture, well, this picture as well, but also the architecture is the reason why I am here. So not only the representation of the architecture, but the architecture itself, because this is a picture of other picture from the Pavaglione, which is a strange and unique quadriporticus, quite big in the middle of nowhere, because Lugo is quite isolated in the countryside, in a land called the lowlands of Romagna. This is from the 70s. This is from post-war II, 1946. It was heavily bombarded. And this is a picture in 2014, right before its renovation. And the human figure give you the scale of the building. So for my students, weighting is very important in photography. And in 2015, the Pavaglione was renovated by a team of architects and landscape architects, including Professor Enrica Dallara. And this is why we met, where and why we met. And since 2015, we have started a dialogue. And I'm very happy and grateful that Enrica invited me here. This is basically the reason why, actually. And this is a picture that I took in 2019 and that was published in a publication where a Enrique contribution l'atmosfera nel progetto di paesaggio, the atmosphere in the landscape project, was published by Il Mulino, a very important Italian publisher. And this is after, this is one of the views of the new restoration work. So, and this is actually the restoration brought back life in the main square, because it's a building that was designed for commercial purposes to organize the local market, and in time has been used for cultural events, but before the renovation that didn't happen anymore because it was quite ruined and people just didn't go there. And now it has come to life again. And eventually I take pictures to events, to crowds, and this is a concert in 2020. So back to conceptual photography. This has been an important starting point for me. As I mentioned before, in the last 20 years, mostly, basically, I have investigated my hometown like a very small piece of land with both a curatorial and artistic practice. I would like quickly to address first the curatorial practice that, again, was built upon this picture. In fact, at some point in my career, I had the chance to work and assist Olivo Barbieri, who is a major figure in Italian photography. He's in a lot of museum collections, galleries. And starting from the Lugo picture, I asked him if he was happy and willing to go back to Lugo 20 years later and explore the landscape again with his new approach. And in those days, in 2007, he had recently started a project of investigating the landscape through an helicopter with an interesting technique that in architecture is used like in the opposite way of this one, to get everything in focus, everything straight, while you use the other way around, and with also combined with overexposure technique. Everything he takes picture of looks like its model, looks like fake, while actually this is like pure film photography, printed analog. So it creates like a sort of almost a visual paradox or a visual ambiguity. And visual ambiguities are good in photography. And the title of this project was Lugo e il mare, and the idea was to explore the landscape that separates Lugo from the sea, il mare means the sea, following some architectures that connects culturally and historically that region, because it was una palude, a swamp that was recollected, and then all the infrastructure are still from the fascist era. All the artificial river flows were basically built back in those days, and also some interesting and strange architecture, quite brutalist, but that during the fascists were used to organize the holidays of the families, le colonie, the colonies. This is another picture of them. They are really huge. Now they are abandoned in the landscape, but still very close to the riverside. And so by helicopter, you can take picture in a way. The helicopter justifies some of the viewpoints. And also I really like this shape of a Greek P. This building shaped as a Greek P is quite interesting also in relation to rationalist architecture. So we published this book, Olivo Barbieri, Lugo il mare, Lugo and the sea, acknowledging obviously the picture from Viaggio in Italia. And this was the first book of a project that I then called Lugo Land, putting together the word Lugo and land, landscape, or terra, that since 2005 has been a permanent, and it's still active, and we are a team of maybe now we are like 7 people. Now there are other teachers. My colleague Sue Barr from the AA, also a photographer, Francesco Neri, photographer with whom I have done a very close path, Filippo Nostri, who is my brother and a graphic designer, Anna Biagetti, other people who contribute in deciding which are the you know, the projects to take on. So basically it's a permanent research lab on photography and publishing, which aims to build a visual archive. So the visual archive for me is very important because pictures actually are like what is left of a critical and an artistic investigation. They are like traces, and in time I really like how archives are built and how meaningful they are for me, or for what I have the chance to experience in my professional life. And also, since 2004, for a number of reasons that now I quickly will address, we collaborate with quite important cultural institutions and universities. Again, we have created a number of books. All the graphic design has been done by Filippo Nostri, and the educational projects by Terry Atkins, Sue Barr, me, and my friend Francesco Neri. We have done now 16 publications, basically one or two publications every year, because I really like the book form. I have learned photography through books, and despite in my recent years I had the chance to do a PhD, I'm basically a self-taught photographer because my background is in sociology. I never studied photography in art schools initially. And the name of Lugoland came from this map, which is the first map that is known of Lugo as a urbanistic place, even though it existed way before. Is from 1568 by architect Alfonso Corno, and the map is called Terra di Lugo, Land of Lugo. So from there I got the name Lugoland. Recently the Lugoland archive has been included in an Italian census of photography, and it has been recognized as a collection. A collection, technically, is a collection of similar objects which are conducted with pre-established criteria based on historical, artistic, or intrinsic value. So basically, is a group of pictures with a certain coherence, and I was happy that they recognized this to the Lugoland Archive, which consists nowadays of 17 original prints. And at first, when we started doing that, we you know, this was not the goal. It's just something that has been built over time. I'm showing you a bit randomly some photographs from this collection. And it's a collection that of people who sometimes they came to Lugo from a long way, and they stayed in Lugo for a short period of time, and they have responded to the landscape a bit out of the blue, like if they were parachuted in Lugo. One of those is American photographer, international photographer, Tim Davis. He actually did a very interesting body of work with the 4x5 camera. His work deals about surfaces of the city. A really like this picture because it looks like a foggy landscape, because my place is really foggy, and other surfaces of the city. But also, he wrote an interesting text, and the text is called Seeing Through Lugo. And I like this idea of Lugo, that it, I mean, it's not a place that is more important than other places. It's just there. And what is important is the act of seeing and the quality of the act of seeing. A picture by Irish photographer David Farrell, a project he did in 2007, and it's called Neither Near Nor Far Away in Lugo, and it deals with our foggy and misty landscape. Unintentionally, because this was just what he found when he when he came to Lugo, and I'm very happy, very proud of that photographic legend. Almost, I mean, no, it's like a real legend, Graciela Iturbide, Mexican photographer. She was a student of Manuel Alvarez Bravo, super important figure also culturally in Mexico. She did a body of work in 2008, and those masters are in dialogue with younger photographers or emerging photographers, both Italians and not Italians, and differently from Graciela Iturbide or Tim Davis, all these other Italian photographers like Marcello Galvani, with another friend of mine who studied with Guido Guidi as well at the Academy of Fine Arts in Ravenna, is he lives there, he belongs there, he works consistently on very close to where I live, and so through Lugoland we published his first book of photographs. Amazing photographer. So, different photography of different, slightly different nature, but always in this documentary style or in the documentary tradition. Guido Guidi, this is a very subtle and refined work by Guido Guidi, il maestro. It would be. I would have a lot to say about this picture, but let's just have a look at some of the picture of the collection. This is a young photographer from Iran, Muhammad Reza Mizrahi, who came to Lugo in 2013. A series from another friend, Francesco Neri, beautiful body of work with large format portraits of farmers nearby Lugo, Faenza. All these photographs are not necessarily about Lugo, but they are nearby in a geographical area that it has not like clear defined borders, but somehow it speaks about the land, obviously. These photographs are also in museum collections, like the work of Emma Ressel. This picture was quite interesting, that after she came to Lugo, she managed to, this photograph entered the collection of the Philadelphia Museum of Art. So some of the pictures that are in the collection of Lugoland are also in the collection of other museums. So in a way, this makes me happy, obviously. And another work by Blanche Bruce, which is a project of this man, Terry Atkins, amazing, wonderful friend of mine who unfortunately died years ago, and incredible artist whose work was one of the main artists of the Venice Biennale in 2015. In Venice. This is one of his sculptures. And when Terry came to Lugo, before leaving, he asked me and suggested me to work with students, to work with MFA students from UPenn, where he was teaching. Something I would never have thought about. And then suddenly I started working with American University, and this gave me idea to connect with other university. And it is why I started a relationship with the AA in London and Bard College in the Hudson Valley, where the photography program is directed by Stephen Shore, like a major figure in photography. So all these universities, they send students to Lugo. We do workshop, sometimes it's class workshop, sometimes it's art residency, where a person, an artist is invited to Lugo to respond to the place and contribute to the archive, like an American photographer, Richard Max Gavrich, very young, very talented. And this is also how I got in touch with the University of Plymouth, and I had the chance finally to build, to deepen my research and start a PhD, which has definitely changed the way I think about place, landscape, and also my own work. So I'd like to show you some of my work now as a photographer. And the second title of this presentation is Four Courtyards. Four Courtyards presents four photographic series that together they form a conceptual assemblage. These series, they all arise from small courtyards in Lugo. Different courtyards in different moments of time, but are photographs that I discovered, that I re-edited, that I took, and at some point I assembled them through this idea of the courtyards. And for me it was quite interesting to think about trying to respond to a place through images by responding to smaller places within a place in history, and see what this could generate. Also, these four photographic series somehow and through different ways they intersect each other, and they relate to each other. So, a small statement that was taken from my research is that this assemblage obviously does not claim to be fully comprehensive or to describe place, in a comprehensive way. Also, what is interesting is that these four photographic series can be seen as individual bodies of work, not necessarily as a group. They exist individually. In fact, even though by thinking of them together has helped me in creating them, I am publishing them one at a time in a separated ways, not as a body of work where they are all together, but like as individual books. So two of these series are the result of my curatorial practice and of me working on local archives, and two are my own pictures. They in a way are a response to these archives. You can see the dates. The first one is from 1897 to 1913, and then a body of work from post-war period, and then my series are, every series was done more or less in 10 years, starting in 2010. And again, I like the photo books, so they are presented as four individual books. And the first one, Anselmo, is a project that was built around the figure of my grandfather, even though I think it's not a book about my grandfather, but it's more a book about place and a certain cultural habit or a cultural, some cultural references that are coming from a countryside tradition. And it's a photographic narrative. So in the book, it's really important, the photographic narrative and the flow of the picture. It's a sequence of pictures that I've done in 10 years. And I didn't start this project with the intention of actually do a project, but I was. My grandfather was a subject I was photographing among a lot of other places. And at some point, I started isolating the pictures that were taking, that were taken in his courtyard. And I started noticing these strange, little, weird objects that he was doing in his everyday practice, like fixing, adjusting, renovating. Sometimes it's more clear what these objects, you know, the use of these objects. Sometimes it was a mystery to me as well, and I didn't wanted to ask. I just was interested in how strange and enigmatic they look like, and plus I wanted through photography to even increase the enigma. I took pictures. Eventually, I took pictures also portrait of my grandfather in his everyday, like stopping him from his everyday practice, and he just didn't really understand why, but he was happy to do it. So this was a part. It became part of our relationship for a while, and that was also quite funny and touching for me as well. Sometimes the sequence is intertwined by more open landscape, taking views from the courtyard, from the house where he lives, and is also the place where I grew up. So there is also it's also obviously an autobiographical project. For me, photography is. I was having a discussion with Enrica, and for me, photography is really a private act. Photography has helped me in rediscovering things about me, my place, has helped me in creating new establishing new relationships, and in deepen those relationships. Another thing I wanted to show you is that actually the original, the final version of my work is like quite small. The pictures are taken with a large format camera, and they are printed. They are a contact print or slightly enlargements. And I like this this size, the small size. I like the intimacy of it, and I also like the fact that you can carry a box and bring it to Calgary and show the real. And show the real object to the final object to share the real object to the audience and to the people and to new friends rather than just showing them on a screen through scan, because the materiality of photography for me is something that I care about, and photography as an object it's quite an interesting aspect of my practice. So again, some photographs from this Anselmo project. Yeah, that's a strange one. Little incidents. I have all series of fingers, different fingers. I love when there's a new finger. And all these subtle. So working with the field camera and do this observation is quite relaxing. It's like almost a sort of meditation, spending time with these rusted things, trying to find good pictures. This is the first, also the first body of work that I published. Also, I was very happy, and it was quite unexpected. That's also a strange one. I was there, but I didn't quite know what what was that for, but it was great as an image, great image, almost object trouvé. It was quite, let me skip a bit of those because a bit too many. Also moments like this, quite enigmatic and interesting. Again, in the photographic narrative, the same landscape before in a different season with a flood, suggesting the passage of time, obviously, another finger. and this is, yeah, again, maybe in a sequence, there are also subtle ironies where this is the same as this one. It's like more or less is the same as the same function or purpose. So I was quite, I was quite happy and it was quite unexpected when this body of work was shown, exhibited and acquired by the Maxim Museum in Rome. And again, you can see the installation I thought about this installation as a photography as a group of pictures with almost a sculptural feeling. And again, these are the exact prints, are editions from the exact prints. So like the, so actually, again, I was taking pictures of my grandfather for a long time without a project in mind. And the fact of organizing them, selecting those that were taken in the courtyards, this idea was inspired by a group of pictures that I discovered by researching for my PhD in a house in Lugo city center, not far from where I live at all, but I had no idea that that archive existed. It's an archive that belonged to Veronica and Giulia Visani, two sisters. They were part of a family of artists, artists in ceramics, sculpture, paintings, quite famous artists, but Giulia and Veronica were not so well known. This archive is a private archive, even though for a while, for 20 years, they practice as photographers, professional photographers, which also was quite unusual, were quite two unusual figures in those days. But what remains of their archives, this is a self-portrait of these two amazing women, what remains of this archive is only their private album. So professionally, they were portraitists. In the, you know, in the classic rigid portrait, late 19th century, for you know, people who could afford that, or people who just wanted one portrait of a family member, and in their private family album, so basically all the photographs that remains of their archive. There are these incredible spontaneous light moments where the members of the family are depicted in their daily moments, and out of 400 glass plates, more than half of them are taken in the family courtyard, and the family courtyard is still there. So I edited the pictures that were taken in the family courtyard. And I created a sequence of like 50 images where the life, this ordinary life of this, that was happening behind these private walls happens. And also the pictures are very, very different from the ordinary aesthetic of those days. They look like snapshots even if they are taken with glass plates. So it's quite, for me, it was quite a revelation. They were quite beautiful. Also, technically, they are objects with an incredible quality. Also, that's quite interesting. This is the son of Giulia, the youngest, is the son, dressed as a woman, dressed as a little girl. And that was a practice that was quite common back in the days, and I didn't know it, but at some point I saw a painting in a museum in Köln, and this is the Jean Renoir, the French director, son of Auguste Renoir, dressed as a little girl. So it was a common practice. And this is the boy, Carlo, as a teenager. In fact, this body of work goes from 1897 until 1915, so it covers 16 years of work. And this work has inspired, again, the editing of the pictures of my grandfather Anselmo, and also provided a new direction for me to complete that body of work. So, great. Also, in one of the glass plates, in many of the glass plates, there was a little stick, a little tape, piece of tape, and the tape says Courtyard. And that was also something that inspired this approach, this process of selection. So, those are the negative different size. They are all glass plates. This is the studio where the courtyard is still there. So it was quite beautiful to look at the pictures, and outside there was the place where everything happened. And actually, it's interesting that this guy and this man, his uncle, at some point, they established an art school in Lugo in 1893, a very, very interesting art school that I thought it was beautiful because it attracted both young artists, but also artisans who just wanted to refine their practice. So people who were doing like carpenters, mechanics, painters, decorators, they went to this art school to improve their practice. One of the students, when he was a teenager, was Paolo Guerra, the guy for the picture of the primary classroom. That for a while he documented life in Lugo after post-war II, with an incredible energy, with an incredible attitude, also with an incredible raw talent, because he didn't have any train. He was not trained as a photographer. And all these street photographs are quite incredible. And aside from these pictures, he also created, so this picture all document this life, the rebirth of life in Lugo after post-World II, and it's quite strange because all the people seem happy in this town in ruins, but it's also because of the attitude of the photographer. He also, within his archive, which is a vast archive of 60,000 negative 35 millimeter negative. It's quite incredible. There's a body of work quite unique that depicts the interiors. All the pictures are taken inside two little brothels that existed in Lugo until 1955, when the Merlin Law decided to shut them down. And it's a quite unique body of work that I don't know any similar body of work in the Italian culture or in photographic culture in general, apart from the body of work that inspired me to select the photographs of Paolo Guerra from the brothels, the famous Storyville Portraits project by A.G. Bellock, which was also an archive that was forgotten and that was found by photographer Liefried Lender. This photographer, the story is quite mysterious, and you know, nobody knows why this picture was taken. But what is interesting is the friendly relationship, the intimate atmosphere, and the same atmosphere that I found in the picture of Paolo Guerra, where the women are photographed in their domestic moments with a playful and friendship attitude. And actually, the Paolo Guerra, the photographer, was their neighbor, who was living next door, and so he was obviously friends with most of them, and so his wife and family, they were also often going to Paolo's house. But they are extraordinary because they document the ordinary life of something that is very quiet, that happened in the social court for a long time. So these are the pictures of Paolo Guerra together with the pictures of Belloc, just to relate them, because really they are very similar in style and approach, even though they are very different in size, because the pictures of Belloc are 8x10 glass plates, while Paolo Guerra's photographs are 35 millimeters neg. So let me just go through. 30 seconds, damn. So this is the Belloc glass plate, and this is the Belloc, the Paolo Guerra neg. So they are very different objects, and also the quality of the print is quite different, but is interesting then in a different place, with a different camera, in a different moment of time, without knowing each other at all, they have approached a similar subject in the same way, and also a very delicate subject. It's the best. The pictures I like the most in this sequence are like the pictures that he took. This is really beautiful. Some pictures that Paolo Guerra took. On the courtyards of these brothels, where the women are jumping on trees, and they are very, very gentle and very funny, and beautiful, beautiful portrait of these girls, almost as he wanted to set them free in a way. And the last body of work I'm going to show you is just a number of pictures that I'm going to show you without commenting too much on them, because they are pictures, and pictures are like silent objects, and they are supposed to be silent. And also, it's a body of work I'm still struggling to put together. And it's a body of work that also recalls, that also depict ordinary moment in Lugo, my village, starting from the city center and then spiraling away in the countryside, looking for its elusive boundaries. They start from like a geographical center, and then they sort of disappear in the landscape, following what in photography it's called a personal geography, that is supposed to leave some mystery and a lot of space for the viewer looking at the picture. I'll just play. the Visani courtyard today. This is the street today, Vicolo Rocca, where the brothel used to be. Anywhere but. Again, sometimes when I explore the place and I think the picture belongs to a body of work, then I got stuck. I got stuck into something, and that becomes a sort of a new body of work. Like in this case, where I was quite—I couldn't believe when they renovated a little square in front of a little church. They renovated it, and they found a Franciscan necropolis. They found 100 bodies, like that far from digging, not even that much. And it was the place where I used to park my car all the time. And it was quite, even if in Italy it's quite obvious, and everybody knew it. Well, not everybody knew it. The archaeologist knows it, but not ordinary people like me. And I couldn't believe. And so when I saw the situation, I asked for a special permission to document the archaeological dig, which I was given. And I have investigated then this little place for other 2 years. And now probably this will become a separate small body of work, just to acknowledge how sometimes things develop in practice. And also what was really interesting is that during the economic boom, they discovered it and they just didn't care. So this is like the old city, the economic boom, when you know, in the 60s, they just needed to build. You know, everything was happening so fast. And this is the new city, obviously. Now the archaeologists are working together with the workers, and everything goes into the archaeological. But the dig they discovered, the actual old pipes that are literally crossing the skeleton. So that was quite incredible. And so a little parenthesis. These are just pictures of wandering around this countryside where a lot of abandoned houses now are a bit of an urbanistic problem. Enrica, if you want to do something about it, that would be needed. Yeah. Very strange conceptual vernacular sculpture. Abandoned vineyard in Felizio. So an Italian curator in 1989 wrote an interesting, a very beautiful essay, and he curated a very beautiful exhibition called L'insistenza dello sguardo, The Insistence of the Gaze. A kind of photography that does not have the primary intention of fascination. If it is true that fascination is the supreme act of distraction, in the insistence of this gaze, in the tenacious will to scrutinize the surface of things, photography moves decisively towards the inaccessible and mysterious that are hidden in our daily landscape. And this is what I've been trying to do. And with an insistence of this countryside house at dusk, I thank you very much for your attention. Thank you. Sorry. Apologies for being late.
That's right. I think we just expressed our gratitude to you.
Thank you.
Let me just stand here so that it gets recorded.
And I just, it was beautiful work. It was really lovely. And the idea of studying very quietly and carefully a place over and over and then looking at the way in which it was studied, I think is amazing. You spoke about looking through Luca.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's, or
Lugo. Yes,
I was going to say, also people, is looking through, I think what you've shown us tonight is looking through Luca,
it's the same.
Right?
Yeah,
you've
yeah.
shown us
yeah.
how to yeah. see your place through you.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And I think that's really wonderful, and I'm really looking forward to seeing what the students are going to be producing as they're looking at this place.
Yeah, me too.
Yeah, the review, that just put every student's blood pressure up about 10% there. We're running a little bit over time, so I don't know that we've got time for questions, but there's an opportunity afterwards to be able to come up and I'm sure Luca will be happy to answer any questions or comments that you might have. I want to just say a couple of things. First of all, there's so many new faces here tonight, and that's because this is an alumni all-access event. And I wanted to save the last acknowledgement till the end that we're very grateful for the University of Calgary Alumni Association for co-hosting this event with us, inviting all of you here to this. I hope this is not the last or the one and only time that you'll come. We do cool stuff like this regularly. Don't be intimidated. It's always things that are people that are doing really interesting, timely things. And Luca, you're just... I think you brought a tremendous dimension to this evening, to the school, and I just thank you very much for that.
Thank you.
And then finally, if you are interested in seeing the work, there will be an exhibition. It's a little bit harder to get to. You have to go up to the university, but there will be. There's directions on our website. There's an opening event, so there'll be some food and some drinks. And I just have to get the dates. Here on October the 17th, or sorry, on October the 20th, the gallery show is open from the 17th to the 28th, and the opening event, or the event is not an opening, the event is on the 20th, and it would be great to see all of you here. So thank you very much. Please feel free to stay around, and there's a little bit of food left, and carry on the conversation. And thank you once again.
Thank you.